Welcome to Libertarian Counterpoint. I am Art Tuma. With me on the show tonight is Janice Bonser, former and possibly future candidate for Assembly District 10, and Wayne Williams, frequent attendee at the Libertarian Party meetups, and Michael Warnken, who is with us here tonight to tell us about a plan that the Libertarian Party endorsed just a couple weeks ago, or maybe it was last, no, yeah, it could have been last weekend, was it?
Yeah, it was last weekend.
Boy, time flies when you're having fun. Okay, let's start out with you, Michael, telling us what it was the party endorsed.
Yeah, well, thank you, Art. I've been pushing an issue having to do with representation. Not necessarily everybody is aware of the fact that California only has 40 state senators and 80 assemblymen for our now, we almost have 40 million people in the state. So each state senator almost has a million people, and each assemblyman has almost 500,000 people. That's not representation.
Now, are those adults?
No, it's solid people. We have 39,300,000 people, and if you divide it by 40 and 80, you get about 1 million for each senator and 1 million people, or 500,000 people for each assemblyman. And that is absolutely gross. 1850, we became a state. There were about 92,000 people in the state of California, and we had 36 assembly members. So the assembly, which is the lower chamber, which is supposed to be where the common citizen would have access, there was about one rep for every 2,500 people. Today, there's one rep for every 480,000 people.
But not all those people are going to be seeking an interview with their representation.
Well,
a lot of them are children, right?
Yeah, a lot of them are children. But however, you got to base it on something. So the first thing you start with is the population. And, you know, the number of children usually follows up with the number of adults to a certain proportion. But the idea, if we are to have a representative republic, if we're having the notion of a government by a representative, that means you should have access to your representative. And that means some reasonable level of representation. In 1850, they had 36 assemblymen. In 1852, they increased to 63 because the population shot up. And in 1854, they went to 80. And they never increased it. They always maintained about 2,500 to 1. And now you've got 480,000 people. What they do, instead of adding more reps, is they add more assistants. So no longer can you call up your rep, you call up an assistant. There was a wonderful book written by a gentleman called Hill Rat. He refers to them as Hill Rats. So when you call up your congressman or your city councilman or, you know, city councils now, or your state legislative rep, you get a Hill Rat. And unless you really plop down either $10,000 yourself to that guy's campaign or multiple, you know, donations of lesser amounts, you will not hear back from them. And so what I did was I took it to the Libertarian Party and I said, you know, this issue is really important. And I said, it costs lots of money. When you run for office now in California, the winners, they raise $500,000, and the losers can only raise, you know, 10 to 20,000 if they're lucky. If you decrease the size, and by doing that, you'll have to increase the number of reps, what'll happen is it costs less. And I said it'll be easier for libertarians to run. They loved it. I put it as a platform issue. Somebody said, well, maybe we didn't have enough time to do it as a platform, so they did it as a resolution, and it passed almost unanimously by voice vote. I mean, they wanted, because it was the last item, I spent the whole weekend lobbying as many libertarians on the issue as I possibly can. They loved it. And it wasn't on the agenda, so they had to move. They had to ask the convention to allow me. And it took 2/3, and I got that easy. And then I gave a speech on it, and then all of a sudden a ton of people walked up to go to give a speech on it, and somebody called the question, and they overturned him just so they could talk on it. I mean, it was 4 o'clock on that Sunday, everybody wanted to get home, but this issue was so important, they wanted to do something about it, and they did. And it was amazing. They were excited.
Where was that convention?
It was in Lake Tahoe.
And about how many libertarians do you think were showed up there?
I think there were well over 100. I think had it been more centrally planned, a lot more could have been there, and it was snowing like crazy, so that kind of kept people back. But yeah, and my vote, like I say, only 3 people voted no. I mean, you could hear everybody, all those in favor, yeah, I mean, everybody, you know, and then 3 people, nay, you know, and they kind of turned and walked off.
Have you been to previous conventions?
Never been, no, yeah. No.
So other than the snow and maybe more Did you say centrally planned?
Yeah, I didn't mean centrally planned. I meant if it was more in the middle of the state, then, you know, obviously. I think we were in Nevada.
Centrally located.
I think we were in Nevada, believe it or not. We were having the California Libertarian Convention in another state.
Well, maybe that's a sign that other states have.
They have more fun in Nevada. Yeah. That's where you should be.
Are more libertarian than this one.
Nevada is certainly much more libertarian. That is.
Now, you're presenting the issue. Did you talk about cons as well as pros?
Well, there are not really many cons. There really aren't any. You get more access. The common citizen has more access to their representative. You have a problem. You can call your rep. They talk to you. The cons would be if you're a really wealthy, powerful person and you have full access to the legislature stands right now, yeah, sucks to be you because you like it this way. You want as few people to talk to. You want to get, right now it only takes 21 people in the assembly to get something passed. And it only takes, 41 and 21 senators to get anything passed. Mm-hmm. That's fewer people you have to talk to. If all of a sudden that number shot up, that just made your job harder. You have to bribe more people to get your law passed. So that's the count. The cons are, if you like things the way that they are, then you don't want my thing to come forward. If you're concerned about too many police beatings, if you are concerned about the encroachment of the executive state, if you are concerned about the loss of your liberties, if you are concerned about higher taxation, then you need to endorse the idea of increasing the number of reps so you have access to your rep. Because when the number of reps go up, the district size goes down, your vote means more. All of a sudden, you call them. They want to take your call. They want you to know who they are. They want to protect you. If there are very few of them, they don't want you to know who they are. They want you not to talk to them. They want you to hand large, very stuffed full envelopes of cash to them and leave. They don't want to talk
to you. Well, I can understand the technical values of it. The cons that I'm thinking about is the cost, basically.
Okay.
And the cost, every time you add another assemblyman, they're not going to take less money. Senators are not going to take less money, so that means we're multiplying the cost of government, and each one of them is going to want just as big a staff as they had before. I'm just talking about human nature.
And once
they've got 20 people in their office, everybody's going to want 20 people in their office.
The real truth is, in the states that have, like New Hampshire has a population of 1.2 million people, they have 400 reps. So that's one rep for every 3,000. They do not have offices. Their office is their home. Their office is, let's go have coffee. They don't
have. What about compensation?
They pay the reps in New Hampshire $100 a year, and they do it for that. If you increase the number of reps in California, yes, you will decrease the salary, and you want to know something? People will still run. They will, because it's power, and you've decreased their power, and you've decreased their salary, but they will still do it. Because it's that important. They have no problem getting reps in New Hampshire or people to run for the representative positions in New Hampshire. No problem at all. In fact, libertarians have run for office there, and guess what? They've won. In New Hampshire, the winners, they spend $1,000. The losers spend $1,000. And there are people who win who don't spend anything more than the $100 to sign up because they can talk to enough people to win.
Well, New Hampshire is also the target state picked by the Free State Project.
Yeah.
So I imagine there might be more libertarians per total population there than elsewhere.
Well, it also might be the case that the fact that they had so many reps is what made it so libertarian to begin with, and that made it the magnet to bring everybody there.
Could be. Libertarian registration numbers have been going up in recent years compared to the Democrats and Republican numbers who have diminished.
Yes.
Decline to state still is the leading growth sector in voter registration.
Well, it's probably because people don't feel like they're represented by either Democrats or Republicans. When you have a representative government, what that means is agency. What it means is agency. I have a wonderful piece. It was called The History of the Right to Petition, and it was in the Yale Law Journal in 1986. Powerful, powerful, powerful piece. It is truly government by consent. And the biggest fight in that article was between John Quincy Adams and John Calhoun. John Quincy Adams argued the only two ways you had to direct your government was, one, through your vote for your representative, and two, by petitioning your representatives. And he said upon petition, you had a right to a hearing in the legislature, in the committee, dealing with the problem you had. John Calhoun said no. He said upon petition, it's up to your rep what they do with the petition. But let me remind you, John Calhoun was endorsing slavery. And he didn't like those petitions by people who wanted to end slavery. Today, if you have a problem with government, you should be able to petition your representative. Because again, your representative is agency. You're paying taxes, and it's based on the notion that you have access to your representative. In the most natural term possible, in natural law, you do not pay the person who's whipping you. You do not pay the person who's whipping you. You should not fund the very machinery that's damaging you. And in our form of government, the way we have it designed, you're supposed to have access to your rep, not their assistant, not their army of assistants. And according to John Quincy Adams, you should have a right to the legislative body, the lower chamber at the very least, and to be able to present your petition, have it heard, and have it dealt with and discussed. We don't have that today.
Well, I have to admit, in order to even get heard, you have to show up at various fundraising projects.
With a big envelope of cash, right?
Well, something's... Yeah, you know, when the envelope gets passed around, there was a $38,000 plate event that President Obama recently visited. Can you imagine that? $38,000
a plate. Well, who's getting those plates? Banks, right? You know, the people who got you know, all the big stimulus bailout money for making all their bond loans, right?
I'm curious to know who can afford that.
Yeah. That's not me.
And there are people, I'm sure, who hope to get something, protection or favors or something.
You don't give $38,000 for nothing.
Yeah.
You don't give $38,000 for nothing. And if you're giving that kind of money, you're expecting votes for certain issues.
I understand that Democrats plan to raise $1 billion for the next presidential election. Where's that money coming from? Does it not come at the cost of the general welfare?
No, it's just $5 or $10 from you and
yeah.
you and me. And
yeah,
it just comes
it's
from the people.
It's going to show up in the cost.
The grassroots.
It's going to show up in the cost of things that we buy.
Yeah, and the other thing that's interesting is that we put so much focus on the president now, but again, we are a representative republic, and we should have access to our reps. You know, laws are supposed to start in the legislature. There's two duties to a legislative body, and most people don't even know what they are. Reps don't even know what they are. Their first duty is to take petitions for redress of grievances.
Well, in your situation, I can see that maybe a libertarian will get heard, but even if there's only four people that the rep is representing, it's still... like democracy, two wolves and a sheep deciding what to have for lunch.
Well, I've got an excellent paper by a man named Dr. Thornton at the Mises Institute, and he showed that when you add representatives, he said government spending drops. And he showed the correlation at a 95 percentile. He basically said that if you took the 49 states that were bicameral, and he says if you added one more rep to any lower chamber and in $1999 dollars, he said government spending will drop by $5 million. He said if you added another senator to any chamber in the 49 states, he said government spending would drop by $40 million. Hmm. By adding one more rep, it's that much harder to gain consensus. And because it's that much harder to gain a consent, that's one more government program that wouldn't get funded. And that's one less monopoly that the rest of us are forced to pay for.
Well, that's very well may be true, and it does sound to be some logic to it. Tea Party has a different idea. They just replace those that they're spending too much.
Yeah.
And I think they showed that they do have some influence in the last election.
Well, I have been talking to the Tea Party members, and I've been showing them. I said the original fight around 1787, and actually started in 1774 with what was called the Sugar Act. And I showed them that the problem was that England would come over here and they would dissolve our legislative chambers in the 13 colonies. They said you didn't have a right to have your own representatives. They said you were virtually represented in Parliament across the ocean. And our founders decided they didn't like that. And in 1776, we had a revolution because we decided we wanted home rule. And the idea that we had to cross the ocean and petition Parliament, who we didn't even elect them. And there was even a proposal at one point by the British that we would be granted something like three House of Commons members in England for the 13 colonies. Well, that's still pretty sparse.
Wasn't there a slogan at the time, no taxation without representation?
George Washington said 30,000 was representation, 40,000 was tyranny. And he was talking about the U.S. House. He said no member of the U.S. House should represent more than 30,000 people because 40,000 was tyranny.
So how many are in District 10? Do you have any idea, Janice?
It's
more than 40,000, I imagine.
Absolutely.
Oh, 60,000.
Yeah.
Well, each assembly district now, the number of people who vote are about 60,000, but the actual number of people is 480. So that's 12 times.
480,000?
480,000 people.
Yeah.
That's 12.
Close to half a million.
That's 12 times what George Washington said was tyranny at the federal level.
So was he talking about total people or voters?
He was talking about the total number of people. He said no U.S. House rep should have more than 30,000 because very few people had the right and the ability to vote then. He said that when you boiled down the people who were able to vote, which were white men aged 21 and older who had money, it would be about 5,000 or 6,000 people. That was the whole point, that 5,000 or 6,000 would be able to elect the one person from Congress. So they picked districts of 30,000. Today, U.S. Congress has, U.S. House members have 710,000 people per rep.
Yeah, well, I kind of pay attention to those who vote. And those who don't vote are a forest and of human beings. But, I have a special love for human beings as compared to, say, trees.
Yeah.
Unlike so many of the people in the district that I would like to represent.
Yeah.
But even so, a lot of them are voting for another way of doing business, mainly robbing everybody through taxation, again and again, on the same product, just because it changed hands, just because it's put in use in a different jurisdiction, it's taxed.
Yeah.
So the government's just pulling all of these taxes, and it's just. It's not just the national government, it's a government at all levels.
At all levels, yeah. Another thing that I brought up at the convention was county governments. They're governed by Government Code 25,000A, which says every county shall have five. So Alpine County, which has 1,200 people, has five supervisors. Hmm. And LA County, which has 10,800,000, has five. I know, wait, you laugh, but those five supervisors down in LA, they like it. They like having 2 million people. When the number of people in a district increases, fewer people vote. You're able to find the voters who are going to put you in, and you can bribe them more easily. When you have a small district like in New Hampshire, you get near 100% voter turnout rate. Mm. You know who your rep is. And the rep knows who voted and who didn't, and the challenger knows who voted and who didn't. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So everybody comes out to vote. When you get into the LA districts, I mean, some of those elections have, of the 2 million people, 40,000 will vote.
Mm-hmm.
And I hate to say it, about 80% of those are government workers.
Right.
Yeah. So the people who benefit from the tax from us to pay them. Right. Yeah, it's absolutely absurd.
Yeah, it would be great if we could do it. I for one agree with your proposition.
Yeah,
I think I sometimes am a wet blanket because if for every time there's a positive point, I'm seeing kind of the other side of the coin. And for example, to use our governor in California as an example, he, the previous one, I'm not even accepting the current one, the previous one made some promises in his campaign.
Uh-huh.
Well, within the first 2 years, he lived up to those promises. Oh. He actually did get introduced in Congress. He had people really working for those five different issues that he had made promises about, and they were totally blasted by the opposition in the legislature.
Yeah.
So then he went at it again, and in the next 2 years, he put them on the ballot as initiatives,
yeah.
and the big money and the people in the legislature beat them again.
Yeah.
And I hear people knocking Schwarzenegger. I knocked him too because he made a very contradictory statement about whether you can be a fiscal conservative and a social liberal at the same time. You can't. That's an impossibility.
Well,
you have to have lots and lots of money that you have to steal from people in order to be a social liberal. You've got to. So that was a problem for me. But I thought that he was a pretty damn good governor. He made every effort to live up to what he had promised.
And he probably did what the people wanted, but the legislature wasn't there.
Absolutely.
To support him. Yeah.
Absolutely. And I wouldn't blame him for what happened. I know who's to blame. I wouldn't blame him at all.
Well, again, I go back to the problem, which is the legislature. You know, the districts get bigger. They're able to target. The favorability of the legislature in the last 4 years went from 23 to 19. And I hear it's at 9 right now. There's a 9% favorability. And in the last 10 years, one person lost. Only one rep lost. That was Carol Bignan.
Because incumbent, you're talking about.
One incumbent.
Yeah.
One incumbent lost in 10 years.
Yeah.
Because she got caught on tape screaming at a police officer that you can't pull me over. You know, that was on tape. So these are the standards now to lose. That's what you have to do. You have to be caught on tape screaming at a police officer. And then she had a solid challenger in the assembly who was taking her on.
So, well, to speak of the wet blanket effect again, what I think of right away is that however valuable this would be, the Pauls who are in power are not going to agree to it. I mean, almost unanimously, they're going to be against
it. I don't expect them to.
So that means an independent initiative process, and who's going to do that? Every initiative, one of my pet peeves and things that I would really like to see, and I don't know why I don't keep my mouth shut because somebody will ask me why I don't do it, but that is to have an organization whose sole duty is to come up with initiatives every single election, because you know as well as I do that there are always issues to solve.
Yeah.
Always. And there are always people who are very deserving of being recalled, and so that should be part of it, too. Every election, there should be a recall and another initiative on an important subject that can't get solved by the legislature.
In New Hampshire, one in three reps disappears each election. The districts are small enough. If you do not attend to the people in your district, you're out. The districts here are so big, you cannot beat them. Term limits aren't really working, but at least it turns them over. At least it turns them over. The problem with term limits is it passes the power back to the Hill Rats, the chief of staff. Yeah.
I want to say that I think that many people vote decline to state because they've lost heart. They think mistakenly that you get to vote for anybody you want to if you're voting decline to start decline to state. But that's not true. You have to vote for whoever the two most popular parties are. And so then you're really regimented in who you have to vote for instead of the opposite of what they probably thought.
Well, they're declined to state also because, it's an agency issue. You know, we have representatives in California to say we have representatives, but the reality is you should have access to your reps. And if you don't have enough reps, then you don't have that. And again, you shouldn't have access to the Hill Rats. I'm on the phone today talking to a Hill Rat, and I even told him that, and he didn't like to hear it. But I mean, you know, if you vote for somebody, you should be able to talk to them. You know, not the president, but at least your legislative rep.
Well, decline of states are going to get a chance to vote in the primary this next election in California because
Prop 14.
Because of Prop 14, there is not going to be the separation by parties.
Yeah.
Individual candidates can identify which party they affiliate with.
Yeah.
But we're all going to be on the ballot together. We're all going to be required to collect 3,000 signatures in order to waive our filing fees. Didn't know that, did you? Yeah, well, us libertarians only had to collect 150 from registered libertarians. 3,000 signatures. I only have 2,000 registered libertarians in the district.
It'll still have to be registered libertarians in your...
Well, no.
Can it be everybody?
No,
it can be
but any can you imagine a Democrat citing my petition or even a Republican?
I can imagine that. But what you're saying is it's just ominous. What Prop 13 did is in essence, destroyed the third parties.
14.
Oh, excuse me, Prop 14 is destroyed the third parties. And that's, you know, that's awful. It takes competitiveness out of the race. It means the two parties can ignore us even more. And, you know...
Well, I certainly will be catering the opinion and attention of declined state voters.
Yeah.
That's one outcome of this change.
Well, the Republicans, it's my understanding that they're going to start canvassing their own primary on their own. You know, that's not going to be state sanctioned. So, you know, I will say that in my mind, that's actually a good thing. Because I'm kind of dubious of the state controlling all the elections. I mean, that's one of the reasons you had parties, was that the parties would have their own elections and solve their own problems, right? So, I mean, you know, I'm not trying to advocate. You know, I'm giving a backhanded, kudo to Prop 14 for doing one thing that's pulling a little power away from the state. You know, I still don't like it. The idea that you have to collect, 3,000 signatures to get on the ballot, that's odious and ominous. Or
pay the filing fees, thousands, between $1,000 and $2,000, I don't know.
$1,500.
Yeah, $1,500. Mine's going to be about $1,700. So, things change. And, of course, by the time the election comes around, there may be a court case that throws Prop 14 out.
Yeah.
Is
there a good chance of that?
Well, hopefully.
I mean, on the issue, are you aware that they have...
There is a case being prepared. And I don't know what the timing is for it, but...
I think we're going to go through another election, and it's going to be just like the rest. Again, we have elections to say we have elections, but no one loses. And this is just going to make it so the incumbents have a greater opportunity to get reelected. I mean, I think they're bothered by that 14-person commission that's putting people, that's drawing the lines. And I've heard through the blogosphere that they've got a special master who's going to be drawing them more or less in the same way that they've already been drawn. So, which, a certain extent, I certainly hope. Because, the longer we go on with elections that don't, turn people over, the more people have the right to come in and say this is garbage. And they're going to demand real reform.
Well, I appreciate you being on the show tonight, Michael. Hopefully this isn't the last or even the first time we've seen you, and I understand you're a registered libertarian now.
I am a libertarian registered now.
Well, thank you. That's it for the show tonight. Thank you for watching.